Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is John Van Fleet with the Concord Monitor. This is Steve Leone, the editor-in-chief. This is Megan Doyle and Jeremy Blackman. They are the authors of the Seeking Shelter series that you've probably seen in the paper. Tonight, thank you all for coming to this discussion, this community forum. We want to thank First Church for hosting this meeting. We want to thank the panelists for giving their time, and everyone who is willing to be quoted in the series throughout this week. Thank you. Today, Megan and Jeremy's story said momentum is building in the community around this issue, and I think the people in this room tonight are evidence of that. So, thank you, and without further ado, I'd like to introduce our panel. We've got Ellen Groh, Mayor Boulay, Peter Evers, thank you, Andy LaBrie, and David Keller. The discussion tonight will be moderated by our two writers, and they'll ask the questions of the panel. There'll be a moderated discussion, and then we're going to open up to questions from you, the audience. So thank you again. Jeremy, here you go.
And I'll just start out by saying that neither one of us are public speakers, so bear with us. John kind of sold the idea of this meeting by saying, don't worry, 10 people will show up.
He was right.
Yeah, we had 10 people.
There you go. So what we thought we'd start out by doing is really kind of first checking in with you, Ellen, to kind of see. And you also, Peter, just since you're on the steering committee.
Keep the microphone up by your mouth.
Yeah.
It doesn't amplify, so I'll talk loud. It's just for the recording purposes. So, but basically what I thought we'd do is start out by just checking in. Where are we at this moment? I know it's early on, but what has, if anything, the steering committee accomplished in terms of looking for either an interim cold weather shelter, a new location for the resource center, or any other long-term solutions that has been floated out there? So I thought we'd just
okay,
start.
Okay, sounds good. So the steering committee has had two meetings now. One was at the end of October, and the other was just this past Tuesday. So the plan was implemented back in April, but that's when we began to recruit people for the steering committee. So it took all of the spring and the summer to gather this group of 13 people, and then they first had their first meeting in October. So it really is starting up. You have to have a little bit of patience on that. The first meeting, we kind of gave this group an overview of the plan's goals and what the best practices are for meeting those goals. And the second meeting, the group is kind of, and Peter, you can chime in whenever, the group is kind of figuring out their role. The plan is a little vague about these roles, so there's some coming together of everyone. So the priorities that we have, and I should have made my cheat sheet, one of the priorities is to find a new location for the resource center. The plan calls for an expanded resource center that it just has more physical space. Our current resource center is much smaller than this room. And that would have showers and laundry and more space for other service providers to come in and meet with people. And we've been in donated space for the last 6 years, and we've been told that we need to move on because the church needs to use the building for something else. We're very grateful to South Church for letting us have that space all that time, and it's time for us to move on. So that sort of raised that as a priority, the fact that we had to move anyway. And the cold weather shelters deciding that after 11 years of this tremendous work that they've done, that they need to stop being the ones to carry that entire burden. That having a response, I don't even want to say having another cold weather shelter, I want to say having an emergency response is the priority of the steering committee. Because our real goal is to find permanent housing, to create permanent housing for people who have been homeless, and not to put our energy into another 60-bed cold weather shelter. We don't want to duplicate what's been happening. Nothing but gratitude for what has been done, but it's time to really focus on permanent solutions. And the best practices for that, all of the research shows, is to focus on people who have been chronically homeless, the long-term stayers, if you will, the people who have stayed in the cold weather shelters for over 2 months. You know, it's just kind of there for the whole winter. 35 people were in that category last year. Of the 166 people who came through, 35 people stayed there almost the whole winter. If those people were permanently housed, the whole dynamic would shift. Other people came and went in 2 days to 2 weeks, you know, maybe a month, but the entire dynamic would shift. So that's where we really want to put our energy, and that's what we've been talking to the steering committee about. How do we put that into action? How do we jumpstart that?
Peter, what do you think the most immediate goals the steering committee can accomplish, or what have you, the discussions produced so far?
Yeah, thanks. Just before I answer that, can I just thank you guys for covering this so incredibly well over the last couple of weeks? I can't imagine another newspaper being brave enough to step up and give so much space to an issue like this. And it got me to thinking about, well, what, you know, there's probably an immediate need, and then there's a medium-term need and a long-term need. And I think the coalition is beginning to talk in terms of phases about addressing issues that are immediate, such as the shelter. But also, let's address attitudes of our community to those people who struggle with homelessness in a way that begins to tell a different story. It tells a story of hope, and it tells a story of recovery and the ability to achieve permanent housing. And I think that comes from a scientific look at best practices. It's not just about applying goodwill here. It's applying what we know from all over the country. And when Ellen mentioned the Housing First model, there are astonishing results from that don't just speak to the right thing to do for people who struggle. They also speak to cost savings and community benefit. And I think one of the most immediate things we have to do for the coalition's point of view is get that message out, address the stigma that comes with homelessness and the accompanying issues and difficulties that people struggle with, and tell that story. And that sort of brings me around to what I said before, that your ability to cover this story and with the compassion that you did has just been a wonderful start to that.
Yeah.
Sure, that'd be fine.
Thanks, everyone. Peter's response sort of leads into my next question. And we'll start with David and work our way this way in our answers here. What kind of community do you, who are all people who interact with homelessness in different ways, want Concord to be as we address this issue? What sort of attitude would you like our community to have moving forward?
Homeless people are our neighbors. They are not some different, they are not from Mars. They are from Concord. They are from Ware. They are from even Hopkinton. They are from Hooksett. They are our neighbors. Why do they come to Concord? They come to, if you went homeless in Ware, would you like to have a tent somewhere where it was 2 miles to walk to a convenience store? Of course not. You would want to be somewhere where there was access to just the basic necessities of life, and Concord is an easy place for that to happen. So that's the first thing, is that we understand that we're not talking about some group of people that is different from us. They are part of us. And so what that leads to is that we have an understanding that when we're addressing issues related to meeting the needs of homeless people, we're addressing the needs of our neighbors, not of some different group of people that need to be treated in a different way or need to be stigmatized or whatever. So I'm going to pass it on to other people, but I want to start with that sense that we're talking about us.
So I'm Andy, and I've been doing this since 1990, probably too long. But I think that Concord has a great community. We all work together, the city welfare office, the church, to help folks get into housing and to meet their needs. Unfortunately, there are some folks that we're not able to help get into housing for different reasons. But I think we have a great community here, and that we all do help each other and try to help folks get into housing.
I think if I remember the question, I think it's about community, and it's about bringing people from different parts of our community together to have an understanding of a direction that we can all move in. That people have different opinions about what is important in our communities, and people have different interests, and I think it's about telling the stories, about being able to speak to the worth of human beings and the help that can be offered. And it's not good if you've just got one pocket of people in a community that want to do that. You've got to get everybody on board, and I think that's what we should be doing.
Well, good evening, everyone. So you throw a party and you never know whether somebody's going to show up, and my gosh. So I will start by saying that I know the least amount about this issue probably in this room, but I'm smart enough to surround myself with really smart people, and I'm glad I'm here with really smart people over here in this panel. For me, this is a continual learning experience. I don't have a lot of the answers. But I do know that I'm not afraid to answer a lot of questions, or ask a lot of questions. And I'm glad you recognize the Concord Monitor, because over the past 8 years that I've been mayor, oftentimes I felt it my responsibility to raise this issue, to challenge the community. And there are times when I felt like I looked behind me and no one was there. And it is great to just look out and see so many people who care about this issue tonight. That's number one. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that you ran an incredible series. And you treated it with respect of the people you were talking about, the dignity that people deserve. And I really think what you've done in continuing this conversation, particularly at this moment in our time in Concord, is really, really important. Because we know that next year we have a huge issue ahead of us. And too often when decision makers have to make decisions, particularly politicians, we never like to make decisions. We wait to the last possible moment. We're going to avoid it at all costs. But we know we have a year to plan, and we have to take advantage of that time that we have. So what type of community do I want? I want a community who's not afraid to take on the challenges and the stigma that comes with homelessness. I want a community that when you're walking down the street, you talk to everyone. You don't shed your eyes away from someone, that you address everyone that you care and you love about everyone. But I want to continue what we already have. We are an incredible giving community. We can beat ourselves up at times, but we shouldn't, because this Concord community that we live in is unbelievable. And I can give you example after example after example. When the Friendly Kitchen burned down, we rallied as a community and we created an unbelievable environment to put together a beautiful building that supports so many. But I want a community that can do much more. We have to do more. There's no question we can do more. And one of the things that we talked about is a resource center. It is silly to make people run all around the city for services when we can bring those services together and really help somebody, really make a difference in someone's life by just simply bringing those resources together. So I want a community that cares. I want a community that continues to give as it does, and I want a community that actually loves one another, which I think we do. There you go.
I don't think I can add anything to that. Was just really everybody's comments, and to you guys for doing this has been tremendous to bring everybody together. So I see a community where we do look at this as our community's issue to solve together, and I do see that happening, and really appreciative of you guys.
Okay, but to the nitty-gritty, let's just hypothetically say that we get a godsend of money and we want to start some housing first for these 35 individuals who really need to get into housing. How do you convince Steve Leone, editor of the Concord Monitor, husband, father of two young children, to live next door to or near one of these individuals? How do you convince him? I think that is one of the biggest questions that is yet to be answered.
Maybe you heard in the radio today that Seacoast Family Promise, which runs a resource center to assist families that have a high capability of rehousing. They were going to site a resource center in Exeter, and the community turned them down because they were afraid that property values would decrease if there was a resource center for high capacity families in their neighborhood. This is exactly the problem, okay? So everybody in this community wants something to be done about homelessness until it affects us personally, until it's next door to my house, until it's next door to my business, until it's my parking lot that people are walking through. That's a problem. And it's a problem that I think is solved by what I would like to call a conversion of conscience. And a conversion of conscience is something that happens perhaps one person at a time, but it eventually has a way of affecting a community so that the social norm in the community says, homelessness is unacceptable in our town. That is not the way we value people. And when that word gets spoken, then property values don't go down because somebody's moved in next to you, because the community says, this is who we are, this is what we value. And that value translates into the way that we live together. So I think we do need to be aware of the fact that that kind of resistance and that kind of fear and stigmatization is going to be there. And the way it's changed is by a community conversion of conscience. Some of that has been started by these cold weather shelters. I don't know the numbers now, Terry, but I suspect that somewhere in the neighborhood of 600 people in this community have volunteered in these two shelters over the course of 11 years. And that's enough to start, that's tipping this conscience, because people who have volunteered in this shelter understand that there are people in this shelter who read the paper more carefully than I do, who play cribbage better than I do. Okay? And that's what, and that's more important than the fact that they happen to be homeless and I happen to be housed. And that's the, that kind of thing can affect lots more people. And that's where the change, I think, happens that makes it possible for us to make a difference.
When the AIDS epidemic came to New Hampshire long ago, we wanted to do AIDS housing in New Hampshire, and no city would come up to the plate. So we came to Concord, and it was really the zoning board and the planning board who helped us to get our housing here, and we had the first AIDS housing in New Hampshire. And if you look at fellowship housing, it's the same thing. And I think the leadership comes from the city hall to help you get it going and get it operating.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think it happens one person at a time. But I do also think that we need to tell the story, not only from the heart, but also from the benefit of the community as a whole. So if you look at some of the programs that have been successful in the past, you deal with the problem by not placing everybody in one, not putting everybody in one place and having some sort of a sealed off place where people are. You speak to housing, and the housing first issue is great, because what you do is you place and support. It's not a question of sort of the old issue of, if somebody has a problem with alcohol, for instance, you might say, well, you know, get sober first and then we'll provide services for you, which is one of the most bizarre ways of coming at any problem, because we know that addiction and mental health issues are issues that affect, I believe, everybody one way or another, and every family across the lifespan. The idea of giving people shelter, and if you think about the hierarchy of needs, first the shelter, a roof, then you have much better chance of being able to provide the services that help that person get back on their feet and get back into a lifestyle where they're working and they're contributing. And so then that story tells, sort of addresses your issue about, I don't want those people living next to me. It is, ask questions. At Riverbend, we speak about appreciative inquiry. It's about, you know, ask more questions and be less sure about people, and talking to people, and that sort of brings into focus that these people are really like me. It's just that there's a couple of issues along the way of bad luck. then you can prove that by these interventions of providing services that people need over a period of time, for as long as they need it, help people get reintegrated back into the community. And I think that's the story that we have to tell.
I might just add one thing about the Housing First model. I think there could be some misconceptions about it, and we want to hold another community forum probably in late January where we can just educate people about more what it means, how it works, what it doesn't mean, and have some folks who have done it in other communities come in and tell you their stories. And one thing of it is that when we say no strings attached, the strings of a normal tenancy are attached. So you can't, you'll be evicted if you're disturbing your neighbors. The idea is that you have a caseworker that will help you with whatever mental health issues or substance abuse issues you have as you are ready to deal with them. But if you're trashing the place or creating a disturbance, you'll be evicted just like anybody else would. And then our coalition or the community at large will help that person find another place and try again and stick with that person. But so that's what I would say too, is that I think more education needs to happen around what it means and how come it is working in other communities.
I guess one of the difficulties is you know, what is the most realistic way that we fund this? Because one of the most enlightening things that Megan and I came across through our reporting is, one, the fact that, you know, just north of our border, or northeast of our border, you know, Maine has a separate fund established that comes through taxes and is used specifically for homeless resources. There's no fund in the state of New Hampshire that is established that can be used for new ideas. The only money that is coming from the state is used to maintain what we currently have and for homeless, quote unquote, homeless prevention efforts. The funding that comes for new ideas like Housing First is from the federal government, and Concord is currently, you know, lumped into everything in the state of New Hampshire other than Manchester and Nashua. So if we want to apply for any sort of grant, we're going to have to divvy it up between Coos County, Sullivan County, the Seacoast. So I think that is a huge question. And I wonder what the most realistic, should we just pray that some rich billionaire gives us, you know, a wealthy endowment and that can establish?
We'll name the program after it.
David? Want to take this one? You want me to take this one?
Okay,
I have my bracelet on. So first I'll say, I don't think there's not one donor, there's not one source, there's not one pot of money that's going to solve this problem. We had a meeting this morning of our board of directors, and yesterday a couple of us met with Harbor Homes from Nashua and with Community Housing of Maine, Cullen Ryan, two different cities that are really making a dent in their population of chronically homeless people, reducing the number of chronically homeless people. So the money needs to come from several different pockets, different agencies that are now serving people who are homeless, just pivoting a little, just prioritizing people who are chronically homeless, not shifting their entire program, but if the people who have money for housing people who have HIV positive, for example, if two or three of the chronically homeless people here are HIV positive, they can go to that program. If someone else has money through Shelter Plus Care. So it's not going to come from one spot. It's going to be us figuring out of our group of, let's say, 50. We don't know for certain, but around 50 people are chronically homeless in Concord. Figuring out which pocket can we use to help each of those individuals. So it's getting down to individuals, not this just big broad problem. It's looking at each person. What can serve that person? And the other thing is we need to bring in more money. We cannot do it with what the federal government and the state government has on their own. That will not be a problem. So in Nashua, I think it was 1 year ago, a community member started a fund called the Ending Homelessness Fund. And they are going around, and they got a big matching donor. And their goal is $200,000 every year. It's not a once-and-done thing, because this does have, you have to keep paying rent. You have to keep paying that caseworker. But they've raised their first goal. They're headed into year two. So I would love to see us start that in Concord. You get a few big donors to start the pot, and then it's little donors. It's my $50. It's your $50. And we have a fund that doesn't have all the government regulations that come with it, that's there to match government funding, that's there to provide caseworker support. And then we save as a community as a whole, with our ambulance costs go down, our ER visits go down, our police, all of that has been proven to go down when people are housed and can stabilize their life. And it's what we would want to do compassionately as well. So I don't know if anyone wants to add to that.
Well, more specifically, you know, we've talked a little bit also about state money. You know, what's the state role in this? And from the perspective of the panelists here, what role do you think the state needs to play here in Concord to help us address our homeless problem here?
What's the organization, the Housing Coalition, that's working on the funding for the state funding? It's the New Hampshire Housing Coalition.
Housing Action?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Housing Action New Hampshire.
The process is currently underway for shaping a budget for fiscal year starting July 2015 and the next 2 years. That process is underway right now. And homeless and housing advocates, that's people like us, are aware of the fact that the current state budget is that the people who are forming that budget in the Bureau of Homeless and Housing are being asked to present a budget that is less than what they were spending the last 2 years. And so homeless advocates are beginning a process that you can have access to and hear about that is community people. This is ironic that we have to do this, but we have to beg as loud as we can to level fund homeless services in this state. We don't even dare to ask for more resources. We have to make sure that at least it's level funded. And that advocacy is out there. And I'm here to tell you that if the communities of New Hampshire don't impress upon their representatives the importance of at least maintaining the services that currently exist, we're going to be in deeper trouble, and our ability to really craft excellent solutions is going to be more difficult because the current services that maintain the status quo are going to be more and more strapped, and that's just not acceptable. But if the communities don't say something to their representatives, the representatives will say, we have not an income problem, we have a revenue problem. You've heard this. And this is where it will go, and it will not be pretty. But how does it change? It changes by us saying, no, this is what we want. We want at least level funding for those resources.
New Hampshire has a program called the Security Deposit Guarantee Fund. It's a program where if you're homeless or at imminent risk of homelessness, you can borrow a security deposit from an agency in town or statewide. Currently, that program, I believe it's funded at $2 million. We are down to the last $300,000 because of the need. If the legislators do not increase that amount, then we will no longer be able to help folks with security deposits very soon.
So, since we have a few legislators here in the room, why not take advantage of this moment? Today I signed a letter that I sent to the governor asking her, when she puts together her budget to present to the legislature, that she fund exactly what we're talking about, these programs in terms of human services and the homeless division dealing with homelessness. But you know, the city of Concord, anyone want to take a guess at what we receive from the state of New Hampshire for all the services we provide to them each year? Anybody got a guess? $60,000 a year. That's what we get. State budget, the city of Concord receives $60,000 a year. But we provide police protection, fire protection. We make sure those streets are well plowed, right? Because we don't want any legislator to trip and fall across the street on their way to the state house, right?
Well, I can think of a few.
We maintain the city very, very well, so they're safe. We keep it well lit so they get to their cars late at night when they're cold, and right? Well, you know what? I read in the paper the other day, I saw a bunch of legislators get up and say they wanted to fund LCHIP, wonderful program. for open space. They want to take care of it. Well, I would argue that it's about time we start to prioritize people. Fund the budget. Fund programs that help people so that we don't have to deal with homeless shelters, so that we don't have to keep people out in the cold, so that I don't have to read about and get the call at my house as to my daughter and I are behind Market Basket and we have no place to go. All right? I don't want to get those calls anymore. So I'll keep plowing your streets and making sure you're safe to cross to get to the State House, and I'm asking you in return. Can you tell I'm fired up a little bit?
Yeah.
Yeah, go! Preach, Jim!
Fund the programs. Now, unfortunately, the representatives we have here tonight are incredibly wonderful people, and they actually already agree with me, so it's easy to talk to. But they all have neighbors. They have friends. Tell your fellow legislators. This makes a difference. It makes a difference. You talk about the New Hampshire Advantage. You want to talk about the New Hampshire Advantage? The New Hampshire Advantage is about caring for people to make sure that they're not cold, they're not hungry.
All right, well, we have more questions. We could talk about this forever, but the whole point of this was to open it up for people who read the series who might have questions for our panelists or complaints or concerns. So if anyone has questions, we'd love to come by and let you ask them.
Thank you, and that was a great series of articles. Thank you for doing that. One of you mentioned that there's a tax in Maine that goes towards specifically funding homeless services. What kind of a tax is that?
You had said that. Was it on vehicles? I think it was on vehicles.
Yeah.
Land transfer.
It's a real estate tax. Yeah.
The real estate transfer tax.
Yeah, real estate transfer, yeah.
In the 1980s, the Maine legislature designated a portion of the real estate transfer tax to what's called the Housing Opportunities for Maine Fund. And that goes toward a range of affordable housing projects, including Community Housing of Maine, which was a portion of our series this week.
And what better opportunity to raise some dollars that are necessary? Do you realize in the state budget, we put our liquor stores on the highway, right? Mm. Buy your booze. Go to, you know, right?
Send our kids to school. Buy our booze.
But a portion of those sales goes to fund the governor's commission on, help me, alcohol and drug abuse, right? Who here has a dog? Anybody here have a dog? Anybody have a dog?
Yeah.
And all your dogs are registered, right, with the city? That was the right answer. Thank you very much. And when you pay that registration, there's a portion of that that goes to a spay-neuter program. So for those animals who are not spayed and you need help, you can actually go get a free spay or neuter from your reduced cost. Who's married here? Anybody married? There you go. Well, guess what? When you go get your marriage license, right, a portion of that fee goes to pay for domestic violence programs. This is not a new concept. This is not a new concept at all. We all run in fear for the word tax. We run in fear for the word fee. But at the end of the day, sometimes you got to step up and do the right thing. So maybe Maine has it right once. And
Well, it should also be mentioned that Maine is not the only state who has a tax like that. So it's not an anomaly. But go in the back.
I read all five articles, and I don't know how many people are on that around the special committee, but I think a good place to start, where you really start in anything, is facts in what is a baseline. Let's see what a baseline is. And I think a place to start there is to say, if there's a Department of Human Services that funds the homeless, I know I read in the paper 1,500 homeless, 1,600 homeless, the city provides $287,000 of money for the homeless operation. If there's a Department of Human Services that part of this is, a good place to start would say, what percentage of that Department of Human Services budget is directed for homelessness? Is it 2%, 5%, 10%? And then say the Department of Human Services portion for homelessness, what percentage of that is to the entire city budget? And then look at other cities throughout the country, whether it's Baltimore, Chicago, or any other city that's within, let's say, $50,000 or $100,000 population, and find out specifically what those items are in their budgets. and make sure that the line items that you're matching are specific, so you're not double counting anything. Then there's a place to start to say, gee, in the city of Concord, we devote 3% of our entire budget to the homeless population. 90% of the sample, which might be 50 cities or 40 cities, devotes 25%. That means we got a big hill to climb, and on a percentage basis, it doesn't make any difference whether it's Chicago or Texas or New York City, but at least there's a baseline that says we're close, we're equal to what other cities in the country are doing, we're below, we're above, and let's see how we can make it affordable in that grouping. And I don't know where that comes from. It's got to come from somebody in the city to say, we have a gap, how do we fill it? Then take that same baseline to the state and say, in the state's budget, how much do you give for homeless? And on a percentage basis in the state, how does that compare to Pennsylvania? How does it compare to New Jersey or Detroit? And that would be a baseline to say where we start. My other suggestion would be within the Concord homeless organization, maybe there's an offshoot that's developed that's called the Interfaith Council for the Homeless, where all the churches combined have one representative, and they meet and they decide how often and which churches will also have winter shelters, because you can have permanent housing and still at the same time say there's nothing for somebody who is in a part-time shelter, because the permanent housing is going to come way after everybody else is in their shelters. So I think there ought to be an aggregate umbrella church organization that looks at the population of the homeless and decides within their churches if they have to move something to make 30, 20, 40 beds, they should all act together. Thank you.
I think your first idea sounds like a follow-up article for us, actually. Okay.
I have a question for the mayor. My name is Lisa Irina. I'm a Christian missionary from the Dominican Republic. I'm really concerned about our homeless situation. That was very sad for me on the 27th of Thanksgiving Day, how our homeless people was suffering outside in that cold weather. And I see in the newspaper when the governor say, oh, we open shelter for the family that lost electricity, power. But I didn't see anything opening for the homeless people that was frozen in the street. I was forced to open in a homeless camp, Good Samaritan, that was shut down on the 5th, October 5th by the state. I had no choice. I had that person, and this that was the first guest from my homeless camp. He was in that situation. When he got out of Concord Hospital for 5 months and a half waiting for the nursing home in the waiting list, nobody called, so he had no choice to go out. So I have to do this, and it was very sad for me when the state shut down my homeless camp, Good Samaritan. I pray the Lord, the city and the state and the community, we work together for the best of our homeless community. We don't have a cold here from now, because remember, the cold starts sometime early, October, November, and then December. So I hope the city and the state and the whole community, as a people that care and compassion, work with our homeless people. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, I too want to commend the monitor for a wonderful job, and I'm sure, or at least I certainly hope, it changed a lot of attitudes about the homeless and took away the stereotypes. But there is one gap that I saw, and I know you need to focus on the chronically homeless, and that's your whole goal. But we can't forget the families with children and the homeless teens. I have been working with a task force since 2008. Trying to get a teen shelter in the state. Some rules have actually been changed, and we visited shelters in Maine and in Vermont and the Bridge Over Troubled Waters in Boston, and it is possible in New Hampshire, but of course it's always all about the dollars. So it may be another project for the the monitor to focus on children and teens. I know a few years ago, state reps had no clue. You mean, Liz, you mean we have homeless teenagers in this state? And, you know, again, we need to educate the masses, I guess, to get the word out and the awareness and do something about it. So, thank you.
Hi, I just want to keep it simple and sweet. A lot of words were said between the newspapers, between what was said here. I just want to say thank you.
Thanks, Terry.
I'm just a little discouraged right now because I spend a lot of time with the homeless. I was once homeless myself. I'm just a little discouraged when they started kicking the people out and posting all the land and not having a place for these people to go. So I know they trashed the land or whatever they did, but it was their property at that time. It wasn't their property, but they thought it was their property at that time. And I thought it was just very discouraging for me to see them get kicked off the land and forced into the city with nowhere to go. So there's got to be a solution for that, too. It's very frustrating for me to be living out, say, in a wood pot, yeah, and the other people that are with me are trashed the land or something, and then all of a sudden the state comes in and says, I got to move. Well, where can I move to? Anywhere but the edge of the town would be fine, but you can't live in the city. So I just hope there's more of a solution to that, or even, I'm glad, I really wish I had my posted land in East Concord if we didn't have to sell it at that point, because I would have opened a homeless camp for these people, and I would have maintained it, and I would have took care of it, and I wouldn't have fought it all the way to the end, because these people need a place to stay, and they're people just like you and I and everybody else. So I'm sorry I'm a little nervous, I don't very... not good at a public speaking, but I just wanted to say, it's frustrating, like I said, to kick these people out the land and give them no place to live. So I asked the people, where did they go? Oh, they went out of sight. So, okay, so you're out of sight now, but then they found where they were again and moved them again. So now they got to go more out of sight. These people need the resources that they have in the city itself. So they're not going to go 10, 15 miles out of the city. Then they're going to have to try to get back to the city. So there's got to be more solutions for everything else. I'm just frustrated with that, and that's all I got. Thank you. Thanks,
Robert. Jeremy Lightning. You're right, Robert, and this is exactly what Housing First does. What we're not interested in is allowing people to stay homeless. What we're interested in is creating the opportunity for people who had been staying in camps to move into the kind of housing that Ellen's been talking about. What we know is that it is entirely possible within the space of 9 months to 12 months to actually begin having those units available. The funding, the resources, the ideas, it is possible to do that in a relatively short period of time so that people who have been camping out no longer need to camp out because they've got an opportunity for an affordable place to live with supports. That's where this is going.
My name is Erin Kelly, and I work for Child and Family Services. And going off of one of the things that Liz said, I sit in the same task force with her. And I would encourage you all to look at the youth and young adult population in your community. There are a number of unaccompanied youth who are minors who are homeless in Concord. We have a transitional living program that's about 2 minutes from here. And we have 6 beds for youth who are 18 to 21 who are experiencing homelessness. And those beds are full every day with an extensive waiting list. And when we think about our young adult population, we have to remember that they are our emerging adults. And it takes 3 to 4 months of a young adult who is experiencing homelessness to hang out with a chronically homeless population before they start assimilating into that population and adapting and adopting those sorts of behaviors and assuming that that's going to be their trajectory in their life. So when you're thinking about putting together some sort of programming and some sort of structure to help homeless people, thinking about distinct populations and the youth and young adult population as one of them that need sort of unique services, that one sort of kind or methodology of programming isn't going to meet everybody's needs. Thank you.
Speak to that one. So thank you, and I'm glad that you said that, because we jumped right to the priority for right now, which is chronically homeless people. But that's not to say that there's absolutely other populations, and that's like second on the list, only because we have to start somewhere, and because the evidence has also shown that the people who are chronically homeless use the most resources. It's a small number of people, 50 people. That's less than what's in this room. It's doable. It's totally doable. And this group of people uses a ton of other resources that are hidden. You're not seeing it on your land transfer tax or whatever. You're not seeing it because it's happening all over in the police station and the jail and the emergency room. So that's you're absolutely right. There's other populations that need assistance, and that's on the radar screen as well.
And furthermore, Aaron, one of the things that we talked about with the resource center, you know, we're trying to envision what an expanded resource center would look like and how it would be safe for multiple populations, unaccompanied youth, families with small children, individuals with various kinds of problems. How do you design a space so that everybody who moves in there can feel safe? And we actually have been talking about that with architects and with program specialists to think about how that would happen in such a way that we would create that quality of safety for people seeking assistance in resourcing themselves out of homelessness.
That's good. Hi, my name is Bruce. When I was born, there were 150 million people in the country. Now there are 320 million, and it's still growing. So I don't care how much money we raise now, you're never going to get in front of this problem. There's always going to be people on the perimeter. And they're always going to be the dying, the poor, the sick. And they're always going to be out in front of us, and we're going to be behind because of a growing population. So why don't we just use, they were talking about Vermont and Maine, the best examples for the money that we have now, and apply the money to that. Yes, we're always going to be behind. There's no way to catch up. Thank you.
Any response from the panelists about that?
I would say that the housing first model is what people are saying, is what the evidence is showing. But it's this distinction between a shelter and a home. You know, a shelter is great when it's freezing out. A shelter can save a life, absolutely, but it doesn't do anything to end homelessness.
Well, we've got folks like Mr. Belay to make those decisions that are finally, in the end, to take the responsibility off our shoulders and him to have to make those hard decisions.
I would just say that Mayor Belay is representing all of us. It is us who are going to solve this. And we're just trying to move everybody's attention to permanent housing and not just say, let's build a 100-bed shelter.
Whatever works.
Okay.
I think this raises an interesting point, which is actually just came out this week, which is the state numbers for the homeless population in New Hampshire. And, you know, the state numbers are declining. Which might be a good sign if you're not living in Concord, because the numbers in Merrimack County have stayed flat for the last 2 years. So I think one of the things we were hoping to also get your thoughts are on is what can we attribute that to? Is that Concord or the county itself falling behind in terms of its services and its prevention efforts? Or is that us being too good and being too attractive? Or is that just how the cards fall, and that's where, because we're right smack dab in the center of the state.
There's somebody over there who actually, I think, has an answer.
Hi, my name's Liz. I actually worked for Community Action Program for 5 years working with the homeless. And I think one thing that you really need to pay attention to is those numbers right there you're getting from what's called a pit count. It is a one-day snapshot. So if... last, you know, 2 years ago, I could be working on that phone, and the day before that pit count, I could get 50 calls. But on the day of the pit count, I can get 2. Guess what's going to get recorded in those numbers that you're looking at? It's the 2 that called me on that day. So your decline of the amount of people that are actually homeless in New Hampshire, Concord, Merrimack County could be 4 or 5 times that number that you're really thinking of, and what's being reported. My second thing is that I don't know if everybody understands chronically homeless is, and what the actual HUD definition for that is, and I know what it is, but I will say it wrong, but I think it's important to understand that the housing first is for chronically homeless under HUD definition, and it's not what everybody thinks is what chronically homeless truly is.
Speak to that one. So, and I might get the definition not exactly perfect, but it's either homeless for a year solid and have some kind of disabling condition, or homeless 4 episodes of homelessness in the last 3 years and a disabling condition. And that is what HUD says. And when I use the term housing first, I wouldn't necessarily, especially if we have this fund that is privately coming together by generous people and doesn't have HUD restrictions on it, I wouldn't hold people to that precise definition. For HUD programs, for a priority, yes, you have to follow HUD's rules when you use HUD's money, but it's not hard and fast like that. There is room for people who I'm talking long-term stayers is another way of just saying someone who's been in those cold weather shelters a long time.
And typically
somebody who's in the cold weather shelters or in the McKenna house for a long time, they typically do have a substance abuse issue or a mental health issue, and that's why they are staying in the shelters that long, because they need some additional support to be able to be housed and access Social Security disability or some other source of income. That's typically why.
Yeah, and I think it was important to on the upside of this, now that we're talking about diseases in terms of addiction and mental health issues, the state has recently expanded Medicaid, and as it expanded Medicaid, it created the New Hampshire Health Protection Plan. Within the Health Protection Plan, there is now a service for substance use disorder services that has never been in the state before. At the same time, there's an initiative called No Wrong Door, and the idea of this is through ServiceLink and other agencies to get people signed up for services. This, I think, is going to make a huge difference because substance abuse services, which have high recovery rates, and mental health services do as well, the treatment really works. We've got to start addressing some of the issues, some of the health issues that people that accompany people in long-term homelessness, and we've really got to push that message that these services are available. We have to stand up that those services, and we have to get people sober, and we have to get people well.
Did you have a comment?
So I work for the state, not for the Bureau of Homeless and Housing, but for addiction services. So, but I do know that there have, you mentioned that you had someone from Harbor Homes coming to talk about, there are a couple of spots in the state, mainly Manchester and Nashua, that adopted a plan to end homelessness years ago, similar to what has just been adopted here. And over those years, they have found ways to build in the kinds of things we're talking about. And because they've been successful, they've now attracted more federal money. And so there's been a lot of housing established, both in Manchester and in Nashua, particularly for chronically homeless, but not solely for them. And I think that's why you're seeing the numbers go down statewide. I really think the statewide is mostly in Nashua and Manchester, which have bigger populations. So I don't think it's that Concord's doing badly. I think it's just that we're not in the forefront of this. You know, we're following behind some larger cities who've had some success. And not to take issue with our mayor, but we do have an alcohol fund that a certain percentage of liquor taxes go to that has not been fully funded but once in the 11 years that it's been in existence, because the legislature takes the money back.
I'd like to say something to the mayor. How about all these buildings they got up here that they're abandoned?
why can't they open them for the homeless?
Which buildings?
Oh, you got a number of them right down here by Store Street.
Oh, the railroad buildings. The old B&M railroad buildings.
Any building.
B&M railroad down by behind the liquor store and behind Granite Group. Store Street.
I can tell you this. You know, a lot of these buildings are, they're privately owned. And, you know, it's tough to work with some of the homeowners. I don't know that there's any city buildings that are vacant at this point.
Are they city or state buildings?
Oh, okay. Oh, all right. So, yeah, we employment security. Employment security. We actually, we just purchased employment security. You're absolutely right. Thank you. But I will tell you this. It is riddled with asbestos. So it makes it very difficult to put folks in when it's riddled with asbestos. Interestingly, the state moved out before they allowed us to do the testing to find out whether there was asbestos in there. That was interesting. So there's not a lot of buildings that are really available in those kind of sense. There is a warehouse that I think people are looking at, but it's not. I wish it was as easy as, hey, there's a building, let's open it up. It's not always that easy. And I know that seems frustrating to folks. It's frustrating to me. But oftentimes those are the stumbling blocks we run into. Why are people kicked out of camps? Probably most of the people in this audience are not going to believe me, but let me tell you, the city doesn't want to go and kick anybody out. It's not something we want to do. But what happens is, when you're on private property, when folks are on private property, that owner has the right to come and say, I'd like them moved. And the railroads are probably some of the most aggressive at getting people to move out. You know, it's not easy for either, trust me.
Jeremy, that young lady's had her hand up forever.
Hello, I'm Amy Lason, and I have a Facebook page that's in my name, and I've tried to spread as much awareness as I can about the homeless people. I've been helping for 12 years. This is one of my guys that I feed daily because he can't make it to the soup kitchen to walk there. One of my guys has no legs. He's been out in the woods by himself, nobody to feed him, nobody to take care of him, so I had to go bring supplies to him every day, feed him every day. The abandoned buildings, there was an abandoned building. All my guys were staying in this building, and the building got boarded up. A week later, Sean Milligan got ran over by the train because that building was boarded up. If the building hadn't been boarded up, my guys would have been in that building safe with the asbestos, yes, but he would still be alive. In Madison, Wisconsin, they have this thing called Little Houses for the Homeless. I don't know if any of you have heard about that. So far, $85,000 has been raised in donations just from private people. I tried to raise money to get Gene's legs back on, my homeless guy, on a GoFundMe, and I only raised $100 for the guy, and he still doesn't have his legs on. So this is a battle we're going to have to fight to raise this money. And we did it to do the soup kitchen. We can do it to do this park. We could put it next to the kitchen. It's the perfect place, perfect land. These houses have sinks, bathrooms, beds. They're warm, solar heated. That's not going to cost as much if they get solar panels. I just don't want to see any more of my people dying out there. They're freezing out there. I'm one person. I'm making a big difference. So if everybody in this room would help out and the whole community, this would not be a problem. And I don't want to lose any more of my guys, and we really need to do something. It's so simple. It really is simple. I mean, I had 30 truckloads donated of clothes from the Concord Hospital last year where I work. It's possible. The whole hospital backs me. We can raise this money to do this plan. That's all I have to say.
We'll take a couple more questions. We're a little over, but we started late.
There's some folks on the floor. Okay.
Okay, I came in a little late, so I apologize if this has been answered, but we're talking a lot about this issue as a City of Concord problem, and aside from funding, and one of the speakers brought this up in terms of Medicaid expansion and mental health services, is there a way that we can be more effectively talking about this at, go beyond the city and talk about this at a state level, and have this conversation as a state and find a way for the state to help the city more with the issue?
Can I
answer that, actually? I don't know that we're going to ever address it at a state level, but I think it's time that we address it at a county level. It's not fair to Concord that the welfare directors from other communities bring people into Concord and prep them because Concord has more resources on what they'll get here and what they won't get from them. That's where I think it needs to be addressed. We have a county jail sitting empty in Blaskwine. That building could be remodeled.
And I will say at the steering committee a couple days ago, that was one of the things that was brought up, was not the state level, but the county level, and how do we approach the county commissioners, because it is a, you know, it is a county problem, it is a county issue. So that's in the, that's at least being discussed at this point, and we're moving on that. And there's some members of the steering committee here. Can I put you guys on the spot? I see Bishop Hirschfeld there and Peter Evers. Is there anyone else from the steering committee here? Bill Davis back there. Anyone else? So, oh, and Ron Waite from the jail. So, and their names are on the, will be on the city, may already be on the city website. They're on our website, so you can find out who those folks are, and you can always share your thoughts with me as well, and I can pass them on.
Ellen, what's the web address for your website?
ConcordHomeless.org. I think some people were having trouble finding our website. And we have a bunch of brochures out there on the table that you can take, and it's got our website. And we're going to try to keep that very up to date with what's happening with the steering committee.
I'm Kiki Vinsel. I'm from NH1 News, and we've talked a little bit about the cold weather. I visited the only shelter that takes families here in Merrimack County the last week, I believe, and they told me during the winter nor'easter we had, or the Thanksgiving Day nor'easter we had, they turned away 11 families that week, and they weren't sure where they were going to go. And I'm just wondering, as a city, is there anything we can do as far as opening up public buildings for these families? Because I understand the cold weather shelter that open up in the city December 13th can't take families.
Well, we have housed some of these families. I work directly with them, so I know what's going on. The way we've been housing them is finding family members who have financial burdens who are willing to take them in if we give them a little bit of money to assist with the increase in electric and water and food. And that's worked for a few, not all of them, but a few. Some of the families we've had here have come here from out of state with huge families and huge medical issues. And the solution for them was to give them the opportunity to go back home where they came from and where their family and support system is. In the last few months, I've had 6 different families or individuals who have come to Concord for looking for a friend, employment, or their bus money ran out here. They have no services. There's no funding to get them back to where they came from. And I'm begging at the churches for bus tickets to send folks back. We have one today.
And speaking further to the family issue, the mayor was instrumental in establishing family cold weather shelters after the cold weather shelters in the churches were no longer able to accept those families. And I was the last director of a family cold weather shelter. Here's what we learned. We had 15 families use that space over the course of a winter time. We spent $40,000. At the end of spending $40,000 housing 15 families for 4 months, we had 2 families that were housed. Both of those one of those families went homeless after they were housed. If you do the math, we could have put those 15 families in rental space for the same amount of money for that four-month period of time. I wrote the mayor a report at the end of it, and I said, please don't ever waste money on this again. House families, don't shelter them.
Remember that line?
Hi, Ken Norton from the NAMI New Hampshire, the National Alliance on Mental Illness, and I have a family member who meets that definition, however you want to define it, as chronically homeless. I have a comment and then two requests. The comment is to just go one step beyond all the thanks to the Concord Monitor to say that it isn't just this five-day series. It's been front page for the Monitor for many months now. There have been opinion pieces repeatedly run. There have been editorials, and I have no doubt that it will continue long after these 5 days are over. And it really shows a deep commitment to community and to community journalism to give these folks, these journalists, free rein to go and do this story and to cover it. And I've certainly felt that commitment around mental illness as well. And I really applaud you for how committed you are to our community, not just the Concord community, because as has been pointed out, these are much larger issues. So that's my comment. My first request is of the steering committee to ask you to appoint somebody who is homeless to the steering committee. And will you publicly commit to that tonight?
Who are you asking?
Well, we've already had this conversation, and I've already said yes, so.
Okay.
Well, it's a huge issue, because 90% of the people on the steering committee are major members of their organizations, and they probably don't work hand in hand with homeless. I had a big problem with that. You know, you had the president of the United Way, and no disrespect to that, honestly, none. How many homeless people has he had the interaction with? And working hand in hand, probably next to none.
It's so important. That is like the most important thing. These guys need a helping hand up. And if we can fund a dog park, why can't we fund a homeless park?
This young lady knows many homeless people. Perhaps she could suggest somebody that might be able to work with you.
I think Ken had another request.
My second request, Mayor, to put you on the spot, I'd like you to to commit to not having the police forcibly remove homeless people from state or city land without first running it through the steering committee and coming up with a plan that is coordinated for what's going to happen at the point that that intervention takes place.
That's unfair.
The
guy's committing a crime. He's
got
to go. People
committing crimes. I want to address that. In the recent past, and I don't know why the last few years it has not happened, the Concord police would always give us outreach workers a heads up that they were going to close a campground. What I used to do, and he's probably not going to like hearing this, I used to convince the cat bus to go over and pick everyone up and their belongings and move them to another site. We have not done that for maybe even 5 years. But in the past, we had done that with the police department working with them. And now that we have two police officers working with us, they're making my job a lot easier.
And you'll hear about those two police officers on Sunday in the Monitor.
Keep going.
I think we've got one more question.
Okay, I'm just going to go here.
This has been a great series and a great gathering here. It's really nice to have so many people here. What is the next step? And here we have all these great people here that are interested in this. Is there a place that we can sign up for committees? Is there someone that we can give our email address to let us know what what's going on. There may be many people in this room that would like to be involved in some way or would like to get involved. So maybe someone would like to sign up to help raise money and find donors to match. So if you have any committees or any sign-ups, let us know.
Open Hands on 208 North Main Street needs volunteers. They're trying sales in days and nights. They can stay open for as long as we have volunteers, and they'll have food. They give away food there, clothes there. We just need volunteers to run the place to keep it open. That's the only thing they need to keep it going and keep it open, so my people aren't out there freezing during the day. So, anybody wants to volunteer?
I need to be calling.
And Marcia, to answer your question, I don't know where you disappeared to. So one of the next steps, I said earlier, we want to have another community forum that's more educational around the housing first model and what it might look like here and how it would take shape. So that I'm hoping for sometime in January, and we'll use the monitor to get the word out on that. But you're right, we should have, that was my bad, I should have had a sign-up sheet here, and I don't have one, but we, you can always, my email, I believe, is on our website.
The brochures.
Yep. So, so email me and keep, you know, watch our website for updates. And then if you want to be involved, please do contact me. And we're in kind of the launching point. This has all been happening very fast. I've been in this position less than a year, and I can feel the momentum growing enormously, and the Concord Monitors helped that tremendously. And things coming together, the church is deciding that this is the last year, I think has been a huge catalyst for us to take more action, to take concerted action together. So, yes.
I want to be clear that it's not like the churches have decided that they don't want to help. The churches can't do it physically. The volunteers and the staff are raring to go wherever if we open emergency cold weather shelter somewhere. It's been very clear on that. That has been very misleading throughout this evening, I think.
Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to mislead. So the church is deciding not to host a shelter. So.
Well, it was a Band-Aid approach.
It was, and would continue to be.
Yeah,
so.
I
think the community has nothing but gratitude to both of those churches, and that was absolutely.
Marcia, another answer to your question, and I really do want to point people to Open Hands, because here's the thing. There are few opportunities for people who use these cold weather shelters through the wintertime to stay warm in the daytime, and Open Hands is one of them. But when they're only open 3 half-days a week, that's not enough. So thinking about that as a way to be helpful is extraordinary. Another thing that's going on is the coalition is putting together its first ever major fundraising event on March 28th, both to create an opportunity to thank the churches for their service over the course of these 11 years, but also to look for ways to raise some big bucks to really move this plan implementation forward. So keep an eye on that. It's going to be called Community Superfest. It's Superfest on steroids. And it's going to be a delightful event with family opportunities in the afternoon and a traditional dinner in the evening, and an attempt to raise a large, large amount of money to make a difference toward this event. So that's something that you all can keep in mind and look at too.
And just to wrap it up, I know there were a number of questions that we didn't get to, and I apologize for that, but part of the reason for this forum was to give you guys a look at who we are, who the steering committee members are, who the city officials are, who the reporters are. So if you see us in the street, stop us and talk to us and ask us more questions and give us a call. Copies of the monitor out there. If you haven't read the series, please pick them up, read them, and you know, talk about this at the.
And those of us who've had our photographs taken are autographing them for $100 a photograph.
Ellen was also asking to remind everyone that there is a vigil tomorrow at 4 p.m. in front of the State House for homelessness.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you guys so much for being here.
Thank you.